Sometimes when you get a couple hundred dollar movement and it's been ranging forever, you just gotta have fun, guys. Welcome to today's episode of Breaking Bitcoin.
Hi everyone, I'm Naomi Brockwell for NBTV and this is Breaking Bitcoin.
And let's get right into it. So obviously need spare no ado. We all know exactly what's going on. Waking up to this nice breakdown, violation of the range, crashing down below support, currently trading at 69.43 from a day. So let's just pull up in the OHLC data of the day. Reached a high today of 71.83.50, currently traded at a low to 69.10, and currently have bounced back about $40 or so up to the 69.43 range. So overall down from open to close, $237 today. So pretty much directly from the open, it's just been a straight shot down as far as today's open has gone. Now there was a little bit of chop, a little bit of range in there, but if you were watching something like aggregator trade, I mean, you just saw it come in. Because I just restarted my machine. So you guys actually can't see this. But prior and throughout most of this movement to the downside, this is the 1 minute, throughout all of this, I mean, it was just, 5 million sell, 2 million sell, 2 million sell, 2 million, and it just kept coming. We can go over to tensor charts. Let's go snag a look at tensor charts real quick. Yes, I am logged in so I can get over to BitMEX stats. We can look at open interest, and this is something that I talked about in my premium analysis and my write-up of the market this morning to the premium members. What I talked about and what I was looking at, I did a lesson on open interest and volume in determining trend direction. And we can see, if we kind of go back, we can see if we zoom out far enough, we can see price moving down, right? This is the 72.20 area. So this is where we were yesterday. And we were talking, it's an area of the market. And I said very, very plainly, I'm like, yeah, guys, I mean, it's never the most pleasant thing to, I got originally short from 72.11, saw price go all the way down to 71, a little bit lower, come all the way back up to 72.20 and reach that peak of 72.40-ish area when my stop loss was at 72.60. I didn't close my trade. I told you guys, I'm going to go ahead and get stopped out on this one. And if we do break to the upside, which is unlikely because my directional bias is bearish and I'm generally good with my directional bias, otherwise I wouldn't be a good trader. Then we'll just take the long or look for a reentry opportunity that way. I like to be proven wrong on a trade. One common thing is that people will get shaken out of trades. And I saw the sentiment yesterday, even during the live chat, and I commented on it. Individuals were saying, oh man, it's not really going to break down. This is really a shakeout. You never know a priori whether a trade is going to work out in your favor, when and how. But you just place your bets and you trust in your strategy and you just let the trade play out the way that it's supposed to. One of the worst things that you can do is faff around with the trade, right? You can, either you end up taking profit too early, you end up, taking a loss too late, right? Not taking the loss when it's early. All these things can come about when you deviate from your strategy and from your plan. So did not deviate from the strategy of the plan yesterday, and it ended up paying out very well. It was a 3% risk trade with a tight stop. So that's a fairly large position size. I've pulled off 50% of my profit now so far. I do have 50% left to ride. And I am targeting the $68 and $6,600 area for the remainder of those take profits. So overall, pretty good. Very good profitable day. Hasn't really made up for a lot. I mean, January's off to a really good start. December closed out December in really good profit. So I closed out the year strong. I'm going to be making a video. I don't want to be like, what's the word I'm looking for? I don't really want to be very graphic about it, because one of the things that I do and I've always preached when it comes to Bitcoin is don't run around telling people how much Bitcoin you have. That's not a good thing. It's not a good thing for OPSEC. It's not a good thing for your own personal security. It's just not, it's kind of a garish thing. You'll never hear me come here on stream and talk, I'll say, hey, I had a good trade and I'm happy about it, which I am. I'm quite happy about it. But it's not a good thing, no matter where you're at in capitalization, to brag, boast, whatever, do anything about, however much money you're making. Because remember, it's not about dollar amount. It's about percentages, right? Especially for individuals who don't have a lot of trading capital, but have the desire to be full-time professional traders. I've consistently said this over and over and over again. In this game, this is an emerging market. There are individuals out there with lots of capital, and there are lots of different ways to do this. If you can consistently, as a trader, pull in 30 to 40% in the cryptocurrency markets a year, annualized. And that's a small number. I mean, most successful traders in crypto are doing more than that. But if you're locking in 30 to 40% a year, maybe even a little less, you can get funded and you can do things. You can do things with that knowledge and with that trading ability, right? So most individuals don't have the grit to get there. And if you take the time to discipline your trading, work on your actual trading, and focus on trading good, not making money. That's the difference, right? I wasn't able to become a full-time trader by focusing on making money. When I first started trading, my first 3 years sucked. I blew out three different accounts. One of those was a five-figure account. I was absolutely terrible at trading because I wanted to make money. That's what I was focused on. I wanted to make money. And when I stopped trying to make money and started trying to trade well, I started making money. So definitely a good lesson to put in the books there, my friend. But anyways, getting back to market information here, what we saw was price overall declining and open interest rising. And what that generally indicates is that the trend is fairly strong to the downside, especially when we saw falling volume, right? So you can correlate open interest and volume and price action. And I think this is better. And then also include order flow data, order flow analysis, to see where the aggressive market selling is taking place. And then you can also utilize the historic snapshot of the order book that TensorCharts allows you with their default charting option. And I think you have right there a very good discretionary setup for success. Now, let me just preach this over and over and over again. But what makes me the majority of my profit as a trader is a trend following, indicator-based, objective, if this, then that strategy, right? Over the last month or so, I've incorporated more of a few discretionary elements into my active trading, and I think people have been very happy about that. It's kind of given me a little bit more to talk about, and it's been a good strategy, especially because I have been trading reversion to the mean in range trading because we've been in a range. So, I do not recommend doing that. I do not recommend even going down this path, really, until you build your reliable, consistent, higher time frame, technical-based, if this, then that strategy. Because that is something that you build, you take time to build, you set it, and then that thing just makes you money day in and day out, or week to week or month to month, depends on how frequent your strategy gives you signals. Some really good daily strategies are only gonna give you, 8 to 10, maybe 15 signals a year, and that's okay. Build there and then start going down, right? A lot of people like dismiss that because they feel that if you're a trader, you need to be trading all the time. No, you don't. What if you devise a strategy that takes 11 trades a year or 8 trades a year or 4 trades a year, but you have a 90% hit rate? I mean, what more could you ask for? Everybody wants that, right? Everybody says that they want that. They're like, yeah, man, if I just knew with high probability 4 times a year that I could put on a almost, risk-free trade, I'd give anything for that. And then people like myself come on YouTube and tell them that that's totally possible. You can absolutely build that. And this is how you do it. They balk at that. And they're like, whoa, this thing isn't catching every reversal on the 30-minute time frame, man. This is garbage. Anyways. Okay. We saw open interest rising, indicating that new short sellers are entering into the market or that new positions are being put on faster than they're being taken off in the direction of the trend, most likely. We do have to assume that, but it's a good assumption. When you combine that with falling volume in as price action is moving down, which is also bearish. So cheat sheet here, guys. Price moving up and volume rising, that's bullish. Price moving up and volume falling is bearish, shows signs of weakness. Price moving down and volume rising is bullish, right? So you should be looking to get out of your trade and potentially maybe to look to go long. Price moving down and volume falling is bearish. Okay, that's how it works. Now, same thing with open interest. Price moving up, open interest moving up is bullish. Price moving up, open interest moving down is bearish. Price moving down, open interest moving up, bearish. Price moving down, open interest moving down is bearish or bullish, reversal. So you can correlate all of those, right? So the best case scenario for bears is when price is moving down, open interest is rising, and volume is falling, right? Now, there is a little bit of nuance here because sometimes open interest rising as price is falling, again, we have to assume, we're assuming that that's new short sellers coming in. It could by all rights be buyers, right? Buying the dip, right? And if there's enough buyers to buy the dip, then the dip is bought and price moves up, right? So open interest, it can be correlated, but you don't want to rely just solely on it because there is that little bit of nuance. But if typically if open interest is rising and price is falling, and this is actually enough buyers buying the dip to push price up, you'll see volume rising as well. If volume's not rising, if volume is falling, it means that it means that there's not a lot of interested buyers stepping up to buy the dip, and it's mostly just people adding new shorts is going to be the correlation that we make there. And that is kind of the bet that you make. Now, what is interesting, you correlate this with liquidations, you correlate this with order flow data, a lot of stuff here. Just kind of wanted to talk about that briefly. So anyways, where are we at right now? This is the 1 minute time frame. We're looking at BitMEX stats. Price is consolidating. Again, we kind of stabbed into a lower low, saw a ton of long liquidations, somewhere in the order of, I want to say maybe aggregate like 20 to 30 million long liquidations just in this last little dumpy dump. We saw obviously a lot more. Actually, this is the most that we've seen as far as licks go. We saw some over here, but not as high. You can see the order of magnitude here is like 600,000. And then when we scroll over here to the right, we can see that that scale jumps up to 10 million. So what do we have here? Yeah, 1.1 million here, 107,000, 9,400. For some reason, it's not showing up for me. But yeah, it's about 10 million, a little bit higher. What is this? About 13 million just on that initial dive down, just on that first bearish red candle of the downside. And we saw, again, here's a massive moving down. Liquidations and falling of open interest fall hand in hand because liquidations are positions forcibly being closed out. So if you are being liquidated, your position is being closed. That is going to equal falling open interest. We do got a little bit of a rising open interest right now, but again, we don't call tops and bottoms. We always get reactionary buybacks, and it doesn't matter to me. I don't try to call tops and bottoms. I wait for price to confirm to me via my indicators, my strategy, that I should be trading in one direction, and then I look to trade in that direction discretionarily because the overall direction right now is to the downside. I would be looking for reentry opportunities to the short side. Would I be trying to short this? No, I wouldn't. Really, movements like this, I've never experienced success really being a classical breakout trader. For me anyways, it always seems that if I trade breakouts, it always seems like I just get punched in the face. So I don't do that. Again, I prefer to trade, if I'm doing breakouts, I prefer to do BPCs or rounded retests. And that's stuff that I go over in the Premium Trading Academy. We've got a little bit of consolidation, which is what's going to happen naturally, and just be patient. Look for reentry opportunities. If you're trying to short this movement, I would definitely be patient because, again, don't go chasing waterfalls. Don't go chasing large red candles. We've been positioned for this for several days now. This was our trade. If you were not positioned for this, then this is not your trade, and there's no need to go chasing it. There are going to be opportunities. Like, I think this is just discipline and self-control. People will see a movement like this after boring activity, and they will maybe fumble it or miss the opportunity or not have positioned in correctly or whatever, taken profit too early or, you know, entered too late, whatever may be the reason. But, you know, you're unsatisfied with the trade or maybe you missed the trade entirely. Well, it doesn't mean that you just need to hop in with less of a good plan than you probably think that you do. You know, if you just see this movement and you go jump into the 30-minute chart and you slap on some Bollinger Bands and you like predict some ideas, that's probably not a good idea. You need to look at the chart the exact same way that you always look at charts and see if there's a setup that fits your strategy. Because remember, nobody else but you trades the way that you trade. So you need to optimize your trading for how you trade. And if you start trying to throw in extra stuff or new stuff just because you heard about it or, you know, some dude said that it was cool on YouTube, you're not familiar with it and you haven't back tested it and you haven't forward tested it, you're going to get yourself into some trouble because really you're just trying to justify FOMO, right? You know that. You're just trying to justify FOMO. So for those of you who caught this movement along with us, great. Congratulations. Take some profit, guys. Always take profit on a take profit candle. And for those of you who didn't catch the movement, it's okay, man. Just chill out. There's going to be a new trade. And I just, you know, sorry if I sound pedantic or condescending. I don't mean to. But this happens all the time. Movements like this will happen. And I will see a good majority of my premium members and general chat members in our community, you know, say, hey, that was great. We caught the movement. But there's always some people who say they didn't catch the movement. And then a little bit later, they'll be like, man, I just got wrecked trying to do X and X, right? So don't be that person. That's who I'm trying to talk to here. I'm trying to talk to the people that missed the movement and are looking and are feeling like, or have already maybe entered into a fairly irrational position, right? Now, if you've well thought this out and you have a plan for this, you have a strategy for this area of the range, you have a strategy for this kind of pattern, all the more power to you. I wish the best of luck. But most of you probably do not. So just relax, wait, be patient, look for a setup. We're going to kind of go look for those setups here in just a minute. So let's get back here. Starting off on the daily, let's...